Great. Thank you. So I was introduced to the business department quickly. So Dr. Martin is an assistant professor at the Department of Economics at the University of Melbourne. Her primary fields are environmental economics and energy economics, and secondary fields in industrial organisation and international development. Dr. Martin's research currently focuses on one, consumer responses to the availability of smart meter data in markets with retail competition, and two, interactions between regulation firms and environmental outcomes in industrialising countries. She has also conducted a recent evaluation of driver responses to road use charges. Dr. Martin has a PhD in agricultural and resource economics from the University of California, Berkeley, and a BA in applied maths from MIT. She spent several years as a research scholar at the International Institute for Applied Systems Analysis, studying the impact of climate change-related disasters on developing countries, and as a consultant for the World Bank in Bolivia, working on productivity and competitiveness, pension reform, and hydrocarbon taxes. So Dr. Martin will discuss who wins and loses from how we currently pay for roads, and how that is likely to change under congestion pricing. Thank you, Dr. Martin.
Getting a PDF into a PowerPoint, we never tried to do that. We take it easy.
Okay, so this project is a project that I did with Sam Thornton. He was a master's student in the Department of Economics last year, and he's now working at the Productivity Commission. So, you've just seen a long presentation on why that we have congestion as a problem. One of the quotes that I quite liked was looking at the UK, where they actually calculated that starting today, going to the end of people's lives, there'll be one in five UK drivers will spend over a year of their life just sitting around in traffic. This is, congestion is a large problem. It's not just a problem here, it's a problem in many cities. And in many cities, actually, worse than. So, being an economist, I tend to think of things in terms of principles like externalities. So, the key externality when you think about driving is the fact that when I decide that I'm going to drive, I take into account the fact that my commute might be affected by congestion, but I don't take into account the fact that me being on the road is going to make congestion a little bit worse for every other person on the road. Right? So, each person's commute might just go up by 30 seconds, but that happens to a whole lot of people. Right? So, that externality ends up being pretty large. Now, there are many different externalities associated with driving. The research has shown, though, that the number one is the waste of time. Number two after that are accidents. And it's only well after that that you have the externality associated with pollution and the air quality in terms of human health, and then the greenhouse gas impact associated with the emissions from transport. So these are big problems, but the waste of time, when you start pricing it out, is an even much larger problem. So we can think of addressing problems from the demand side or from the supply side. Historically, supply side solutions have failed. And this is due to a concept in econ that we call induced demand, which is, you build more roads and they will come, right? And so there's been a number of cases where people said, oh, if only the road got wider, the road gets wider, and more people got on the road, and everyone ends up with more or less the same situation we were before. Durin Turner quantified this using data on lots of road projects in the U.S. and lots of public transportation extensions and congestion alleviation programs in the U.S. And they found it was almost one-to-one in terms of more people getting onto the system as you increase the supply. So what about the demand side? Economists have been talking about, let's try to price congestion for a very long time. Vickery was the first in the 1950s who started writing about this. And not too much yet has happened. Now there are some exceptions, and I have some photos of exceptions here. So we see London has a cordon area, so there's a central zone that you pay to drive into. Singapore has one that I think is the one on the next. Since Singapore has the toll gantries that tell you that there's a different charge based on the exact time of day. We have the Bay Bridge outside of San Francisco charges you a fixed charge based on time of day. So these are not, for instance, the Bay Bridge, this is not a dynamically updating based on the road conditions. This is just every single time, if it is 8 a.m. when I try to drive across the bridge, I'm going to be paying twice as much as if I waited until 10 a.m. to go across. So how are we currently paying for roads? We mainly pay for roads via registration fees and via fuel petrol taxes. Now, different alternatives have been proposed. For instance, some of the ones that Hugh was just talking about. You could charge people per kilometer. So New Zealand has a per kilometer for diesel vehicles. You could charge them, like London, for entering a zone. You could charge people for traveling at peak times on certain roads anywhere on the network. And you could also have these sort of the ultimate, in some ways, the ultimate economist fantasy, which is let's have fees that adjust dynamically to road conditions to guarantee free flow. We had Peter Crampton who gave some presentations in Melbourne about this 6 months ago. Really neat system where you have little devices like this that cost, right now they're pretty expensive. They're closer to $700 per device, but the idea is that if you mass market them, you can get them down to $100. You put them in people's vehicles, and it basically will charge, people get charged as a function of exactly what road they're getting on at the time that they're getting on these roads. Now, most of my research has been in electricity up until now. And electricity, real-time prices, which is why people put in smart meters in the first place, have not taken off. So there's large corporations, like industrial users, that have accepted real-time prices. Customers have not been so keen about them. Now, you know, would this type of system work for roads? When you talk with people like Peter Crampton, he proposes these systems where you basically buy your road use ahead of time and then just get discounts if you choose to not use road time that you thought you were going to use. Right? And so that's a way to sort of separate out the volatility in your charging from the giving people the right incentives to use or not use certain roads at certain times. So what we've done is before I get to that, so the technology for doing this, so one reason why this conversation is getting moved now is we actually can implement a lot of this in a way that we wouldn't have been able to at the time when Vickrey was sort of first writing about it. On the other hand, and then sort of compound, like adding on to that, we have things like car sharing, we have things like autonomous vehicles, all of these reasons as to why congestion pricing might become even more urgent than needed now. But are we ready for this? So, for instance, here, I don't know if you can do it, this being your hardly see that we already have one. So, for instance, this is in Vancouver. Vancouver's been looking at doing congestion pricing. And the worry here, and so there's been some angry popular opposition to this, but also people in favor. And here, the idea is that you have some people who are living out in the only place where they can actually afford to buy a home, and that these are the ones who are going to pay the burden of any sort of congestion pricing that gets put into place. Whereas if you're super wealthy in order to live right near the central area of Vancouver, near your work, these guys aren't going to pay anything. And this is seen as grossly unfair. Similar for New York, we've been talking about doing congestion charging in New York. The mayor of New York was basically saying, well, you know, I haven't seen a single congestion pricing that I think is fair, particularly to folks who live in the outer boroughs. Similar for London, this is seen as a penalty for being. So what we're doing with our research is, and I'll explain the experiment, what we basically is we have a really large field experiment that was run by Transurban with real drivers and where they collected high frequency data. So they put GPS, they put a special GPS in the cars of 1,400 people and we have them driving around for almost a year. And then at some point, the treated groups got different prices. So it was real money. It was in a system of virtual accounts, so you got a certain amount of money every month, minus what they took from that for having represented road charges based on your actual driving use. It could never go negative, so no one was ever penalized for having participated in this. But most people had a positive buffer at the end of every single month, and so you had this opportunity cost of making less money if you did a lot of driving that month, based on the type of plan that you were put on. In this way, they recreate the congestion charges, and they can actually say, well, did this work? Did this not work? To what extent did people change their behavior? Right? So that first, that was going back to the last thing you were talking about, is like, what is the responsiveness? When people adjust, do they adjust in a way that actually reduces congestion? And then the part that we're also very interested in looking at is, well, who wins and loses, one, based on how we currently pay for roads, and two, if we price differently, who will the winners and losers be? So it was Infrastructure Victoria who actually helped facilitate our contact with Transurban for this. They asked us to analyze the raw data for it, and so we were given all the, after a long negotiation to protect all the customer confidentiality, because you know we do have the APS data, so you can actually see a lot about the people who were looking at. So we agreed on a whole process by which the data always stays in a special server and things like that. We were then given the data to analyze. So as I mentioned, large number of cars, long period of time, control group and treated group that were randomly allocated, and then real money allocated over the course of the experiment. People were paid $100 just to participate, and on top of that, they got to keep everything that was in the multiple months of the experiment, if there was a control group. So we're going to focus on, so we have this control group of about 356 households, and we're going to focus on three of the different treatments. One is a distance one. So this is, you get charged 10 cents per kilometer for all driving that you do anywhere that you do. So it's not just on toll roads, it's whenever you leave the privacy cordon around your home and drive out of that, then you start getting charged from your credit account. There's a time of day, which is 8 cents per kilometer off peak or 15 cents per kilometer peak times, where peak is Monday, Friday, 7 to 9 a.m., 3 to 6 p.m. And then there's one that's location-based, where they basically drew a cordon around the CBD area, so larger CBD, where this is CityLink, that's Hoddle, that's north of the university up there. And if you entered that, you were taken from your credit account $8 per day in which you entered the cordon. That one also had an 8 cent per kilometer charge.
That one also?
Yes?
Can you repeat that last thing you said?
This one had the two components. You were both charged 8 cents per kilometer for all kilometers you drove anywhere, and then on top of that, $8 a day for driving into the CBD. Or the CBD cordon, which is a little larger than the main CBD that I think of as CBD. So one of the things that was really neat about this experiment is they got a representative sample of Melbourne drivers. So here, these are the different households. The darker reds are where they had more households that were sampled. And on top of that, I overlay the, this is the commuter rail stops, but we also, when we look at distance to public transit, we're also going to use the tram stops. So in our sample, we have 46% that live within walking distance to the train or tram, where walking distance is defined as 1 kilometer, and 22% live within 500 meters or a 10-minute walk. Now again, this is using the privacy cordon, so these are, we have to make a little bit of assumption on this. Now, one thing that's also nice is that we're able to, in this experiment, basically separate out an income effect from an access to public transport effect. Right? Because when you look across the Melbourne area, you get places that are quite poor, and so here the poor regions are the lighter ones, that are, let's say, quite poor and quite far away from public transport, but you also have areas that are poor and close to public transport, and the same with wealth areas, right? So you have, for instance, a lot of Mornington Peninsula, you get some very wealthy SA1s, so this is the using the census SA1 aggregation, and yet are actually really quite far from public transport. So lots of GPS data. We basically get pings every 6 seconds when the vehicle is in motion. We ourselves then took this and mapped it to the road network, railway station parking lots, tram stops, schools, zoning codes, things like that. Use Google Places to identify nearby shops in order to classify trip type as well. And then we had household surveys from the experiment as well for the participants. So the three hypotheses we really wanted to test is, one, if we just, so our prior looking at this when we looked at these different plans was that if you don't really target congestion, people are going to reduce trips, but they're not going to reduce the trips necessarily that most contribute to congestion, right? So their discretionary trips are not necessarily going to be the ones that you wish were the discretionary trips. So that's the first thing we want to test, and we actually find definitely that's the case, right? So if you're not very targeted at congestion, what people reduce, they reduce high-speed driving far from the CBD, right? They're not necessarily reducing the stuff that will contribute to that will reduce congestion. Now, the per 10 cents per kilometer charge is actually in some ways similar to increasing the price of fuel. Right? So if you think you're going to solve the congestion pricing problem, just by raising higher petrol taxes, you know, the evidence points to it will reduce driving, but it won't necessarily reduce driving in the targeted way that you'd like it to. The second question was, do we see that the low income, particularly the low income living far from public transport, are going to be the ones most hurt by congestion charges? We find no evidence of that. In fact, we all find the opposite of that. And there was also the concern that we find social isolation amongst the elderly. We're not seeing anything that's in line with that either. So my two-slide equivalent of yours, of like, what's the deal with congestion in Melbourne? Here, this is the reciprocal of the average driving speed as observed by our data. And here, our driving speeds are actually driving speeds between GPS blips. And so we're looking at, you know, when you're on the road in a different area, when the blips, how fast are you going? And so what we see is that congestion is not just in the center of the city. This is the average over all times at which people are actually on the road in our sample. And then what we do is when we're going to look at, does this reduce congestion in a few different ways? And one of the ways we're going to do is using the top 25 most congested roads as defined by AusRoads 2016, which overlaps a lot with some of the roads that you were looking at in your study. So just to get a little bit of a sense of what the data shows us, here what I have is these are, of those most congested roads, these are the freeways, these are the main arterial ones. So for instance, Hoddle, Sydney Road would be in this category here. And in red, we have the distribution of speeds at these different times. So this is before 7 a.m., 7 to 9 a.m., 9 a.m. to 3 p.m., 3 to 6 p.m., and after 6 p.m. This is the different distribution of speeds. In red is on a public holiday, and in blue is Monday, Friday, not on a public holiday. And so what you see here is that, in general, you know, the freeways are going faster, especially on these public holidays, but you see that the peak and off-peak, the distribution slides to the left, which just means people are going slower now, right? So you're seeing that sometimes you're still going fast, but in general, you're seeing the congestion here. But the big, sort of the interesting thing for me is that you see that the congestion ends up being super predictable if you're on the freeways. It really is a morning peak, afternoon peak type of shifting of speeds down. Whereas here, if you're looking at the arterials, you know, you're basically, even the midday on a public holiday, you're seeing a distribution that I think this pre-7 a.m. distribution is sort of the, you know, this is the no congestion at all. You're seeing this shift towards the slower speeds kind of consistently, kind of all the time. So it's much harder to predict on these other roads than it would be on just on the freeways. So first, before we do any experimental stuff, just looking at the raw data, what we see is that the low-income households are contributing least to congestion. Right? Now, you might have expected this ahead of time. Here, what we find, so if I'm looking at the lower income, it's 40% of the households in the sample that we have. And of those, half of those are seniors. Right? So in gray, the first area, I'm saying 40% of households and 21% of all the households in the sample are low incomes who are not seniors. So half of our low incomes are low incomes because they're seniors. Now, they might represent 40% of the households, and yet they only represent 3% of the kilometers in the CBD, 14% of the kilometers on these congested arterials, and 19% of kilometers on the congested expressways. Right? So if their contribution were proportional to their number, you'd see 40, 40, 40 across the board, and instead you're seeing much less than that. So the
and then it's even more acute when I'm looking at the ones that are seniors. Households that are far from public transport, so that's slightly more than half of our households, and yet, sort of as expected in a way, because they live so far from the CBD, they're not doing most of the kilometers in the CBD. They're on the congested expressways just as much, but not more than there's some fraction of as total households. And they're also contributing, but not as, even still yet, not as much as their numbers to these congested arteries. The other thing that we find is that this inner city congestion, it really is done by a very small subset of drivers. So our driver, the pool that we got, is representative of the greater Melbourne area. It's not representative of who lives in the CBD, right? And so what we see is that more than half of the trips into the CBD, into our CBD cordon that we observe in the whole sample, are made by less than 5% of the drivers in our sample. So it really is, it is a few people who are contributing a lot to the congestion. So, and again here, so I'm gonna do, do I still have another 5 minutes? Quite? Okay, I'm gonna speak a little faster, sorry about that. So when I then look at, so for the first thing that we do is we say, let's look at a 10 cents per kilometer charge. And what we're going to do is we're going to apply it to everybody, but then what we're going to do is we're going to reduce the fuel taxes, and we're also going to reduce the registration fees as needed to make this revenue neutral. So we're going to increase one type of tax, but we're going to remove other taxes so that the government balance is going to be the same. When we do that, and we're going to then look at how much does your weekly expenditure on this total bucket of transport-related fuels and taxes change, we see that here in green, you're saving money. So basically, across the lower incomes, regardless of how far they are from public transit, they're all saving money. And the ones who are seeing the increase are the people who are far from public transport, but who are actually at pretty high, you know, not necessarily just the highest incomes, but at these relatively high income categories. Now, this is just baseline use. This is not changing prices at all yet. So we then say, well, what happens when you change prices? So we think of this in terms of elasticities. So how does delta here is the change? So what's the percentage change in kilometers from a 1% percentage change in price? And what we do is we think the first, that 10 cent per kilometer one, basically, if I look at what my travel cost is in terms of fuel cost, we're here the variation across vehicles is due to the fact that some people have more fuel efficient vehicles than other. And on average, you're paying 10 cents per kilometer in order in petrol costs across the population in our sample. The experimental variation is then basically exactly doubling that, right? So it's doubling what your marginal cost of travel is gonna be. So what happens when we price? So we basically see this 10 cent per kilometer reduces the distance traveled 8%, reduces the time on the road 6%. However, and I can do it in the price elasticity, which is just in line with the fuel price elasticity that we calculated in other ways. But most of the driving reductions are off-peak times, far from the city center, not on congested roads, and when we look at the time people spend in their car at different speeds and how that time distribution changes, we see that people are then spending less time at speeds 50, 60, 70, 80 kilometers per hour. Right? So these are not speeds that you would actually be driving during congested times. We then look at the charges that are better at targeting congestion, and we really find mixed results, right? So we do see that the time of day based one reduces peak driving, but the peak response is actually really quite small relative to the increase in price. And again, most of the reductions in peak driving are occurring on uncongested roads. Now, sort of in some ways, the good thing is that we see that it's a net reduction. It's not necessarily that people are shifting. It's just that they're still dropping some peak trips. But they're dropping peak trips that weren't necessarily contributing to congestion in the first place. The cordon one does reduce driving in the CBD, but it does it on weekends. Okay? It's a little tricky because technically it was not priced then, but that was actually not super clear in the design. We don't see that people are then starting to drive around the CBD. And we do see that this plan overall does reduce, is the one of the three that we look at that is sort of best at reducing time spent in congested conditions, but it's still not awesome, right? So it's getting in the right direction, but these are still relatively small changes for a pretty big change. So the last thing I just want to do before I stop is then we say, well, let's try to estimate. So before, when I just showed who's better off, worse off, was assuming that there's no change in elasticity. Here, this is taking into account responses. So what I do is we're going to say, let's assume that we have this constant list, we have a demand function that's going to follow this, that has this shape. We're going to parametrize the demand function of the different households based on their driving data. And then we're going to say, you before, you were right here, where you had a certain price of 10 cents per kilometer, you drove a certain amount. When the price goes up to 20 cents per kilometer, you're going to be driving less, right? This is your reduction in driving. And you're going to end up sort of worse off in two ways. One, because this is the driving you still do that you now have to pay a higher price for. And this is the driving that you would have liked to have done if you were paying less, but that you've now decided to not do, right? And so this is this idea of you actually got value out of it. You just didn't get 20 cents of value. You got more than 10, but less than 20. And so this is what drops out. And so what we do is we calculate the change in consumer surplus for all these different households and these different income categories. And so what do we find is, when we assume that everyone has sort of the same elasticity, sort of the same demand curve for all the different groups, and we take into account their elasticity, we see if you don't do the revenue redistribution, there's a new tax, everyone's worse off, right? However, if you redistribute that revenue to offset the other current transport taxes, we see that the lower incomes actually gain in consumer surplus relative to the higher ones. If we allow for the elasticities to actually vary across different groups, and so this is one of the things we find, is we find that the lower incomes are the ones that are responding more, but not the lower income elderly. It's just the lower income, not elderly, who are responding more, then that increase in consumer surplus for the lower groups goes up even more. So in summary, we find that the uniform DMT charges are likely to reduce driving under uncongested condition. The more targeted charges could make moderate improvements at the right time, speeds, places. The low income are contributing the least to congestion externality in the first place and responding the most to uniform charges, right? And so the charges really do need to be targeted. And then finally, we provide evidence that these low income households could benefit from the road use charges if the shift is revenue neutral, right? So if you're using these increased taxes to then offset somebody else.